For hundreds of years, the travelling fair has brought a carnival of joy to towns across Britain. Rides like the Dodgems, Waltzer, and Dive Bomber that thrilled us.
I can remember going on that ride and on the first dip being totally convinced that I was about to be killed. Absolutely convinced.
Bizarre shows that amazed us.
I used to stand like that and open my mouth and then put that in my mouth and that was...
The fairground even had its own unique taste.
There's somebody with a candy floss which is bigger than your head. So you're eating the stuff which is sticking around your face. You emerge plastered in sticky pink sugar. Out here in the fields,
I pop for my meals. And the fair has always been a place to showcase the latest innovation.
Catalysts are the crucible for all forms of modern entertainment that you think of. In the 1890s, the cinematograph. Professional boxing as a sport on the fairground. Even something like bingo owes its origins to the fairground.
But behind the bright lights and candy floss and danger await.
And you have sort of unholy alliance, things going fast. And Sally, take my hand. The travel's soft across land. Pull out the fire and don't look past my shoulder.
No wonder the arrival of the travelling fair sparks such a special kind of magic.
It's a pounding with the beat of the popular music. The lights are flashing on the ghost ride, the dodgems. Everything is heading sensory overload that can carry you away into another dimension of being, a realm of transcendence, a place of beauty, not quite tranquility, but certainly a place of maybe.
The amazing Bat Girl, yes, she's alive, ladies and gentlemen, the first time at your fair. The head of a girl, the body of a bat. Not a wax model there, by not a mechanical figure.
In grey 1950s Britain, the fairground offered a rare look as people flocked to see an array of lurid illusions known as sideshows.
She is real, she is alive, young and beautiful. She is the lady inside, depicted in living flesh and living form.
I've loved going to fairgrounds ever since I was a tiny child. And at those times, there were, but rather than the rides that really interested me, the wonderful row of colour and excitement of the people outside trying to get you into their show. The biggest roll in a bubble bath, of course.
Alive and real, and waiting to meet you on the inside, is the smallest, the most intelligent, and eyes upon in your life.
In the town of Lisburn, 8 miles from Belfast, brothers, sisters, were all normal persons. I'm the only one in the family who never flew. I'm a leprechaun from Ireland.
Three key ingredients were needed to attract the public to these sideshows. A bizarre story, a sense of horror, and a touch of sex.
Horror, that seems to be right down the show row, all the way down. Everybody is getting very close together now. We're getting horror and sex in together. I've said I will gamble to put a show on with just girl on the front of it. Big question mark. Will take money.
Dance, as some people call it, striptease. Now, we call it art, grace and beauty, because...
Now, in the 1950s, there were no page three, a girl, and notice they were all girls in those shows. The headless lady, the girl in the goldfish bowl, the living half lady, they were all girls, all performing in those...
The young lady will take you down to a gay party. She'll find them as Eve.
I can remember my brother urging me, pushing me to go in and see The Invisible Woman.
Step right forward. She is alive and on view the moment you enter the door.
And there was a woman in a bikini, the professor, the man, suddenly she'd disappear. There'd be crackling, oh, where's she gone? We must bring her back. Oh, no, the electrons have gone wrong. And then there'd be a crackling and a pushing, and then suddenly she'd shimmer into view again and disappear. Apparently, it was technology brought from Russia.
Drawing a crowd to this kind of attraction was a fine art performed by the showman, a figure who had been orchestrating all the fun of the fair since the Victorian era.
Gentlemen, when the seventh and last veil falls, she will make the shirts on your backs fly up and down, just like a Venetian blind. The air upon your very head will stand out straight like...
The showman's a quintessentially Victorian figure. He's the person who runs the business of the fairground. He's the one who searches and for the acts. He's the one who books the acts. And he is a figure of great authority. He's a kind of artistic figure, but a commercial one too.
Woman and child, Tilly and Sir Sacred.
The showman was, I suppose, like the Victorian time.
Have you done any wrestling, son? You look a bit small to me. Come up here a moment, let's have a look at you.
He was a manager and an entrepreneur and an innovator, but he was also an actor. He had a persona that he would adopt. Oman was often on the front of the show, calling people in, telling them about the attractions that they would see inside.
You will stand back in wonder and amazement. You may not believe it at first, but it's there before your very eyes. Now, don't worry.
The showman had emerged in the 19th century as fairground to the popular entertainment industry we recognise today. The most famous showman of the Victorian era was Tom Norman.
I think he was a charismatic personality. If there is a wonderful photo, he has a shiny topper and a very sharp moustache, and he's brandishing his gavel because he was not only a showman but an auctioneer. And the auctioneer and the showman have a lot in common. They have to be able to talk. And I guess that was one of... that he could talk up an act just as he would talk up the material that he was going to sell in his auction.
Norman captured the American oddities with extraordinary talents in what became known as the freak show.
It has been there since the Middle Ages. And the fairground freak show, I mean, the sort of display of human oddity or human curiosity. Somebody who was...
Norman would intrigue fairground audiences by concocting an incredible story for each freak show he mounted.
And so this was never the person who had a dreadful skin disease. This was somebody who was born like this because their mother had touched an alligator. Covered in hair. He was the dog-faced boy because his mother was frightened. This was an accepted medical term. It was called maternal impression.
Spinning a tale to attract the curiosity of Victorian fairgoers was Norman's stock in trade.
He kind of advertised Jacko the talking fish, which of course is a sea lion, fish that could play the pianoforte, and it was always the latest wonder of the age. But his motto always was, it was not the show, but the tale that he told. The curiosity attractions is you didn't just go and look at somebody, you looked at somebody who had a talent or a skill, so you'd see them doing what is to us everyday normal things, but it to them is extraordinary. So John Chambers, the armless wonder, would actually be a carpenter with his feet. So all of these people would actually have a particular skill which they'd learnt through adversity because there was no other way of making a living.
Although shocking to modern sensibilities, the fair income to those with disabilities or deformities.
I think that when we look back at the ambition of human oddities, we lump all these people together as though they were just a sort of were celebrities. You know, you could buy little carte de visites of them. You could put their pictures on your mantelpiece. People like the dwarf performers, Charles Stratton, Tom Thumb, these were among some of the most famous people in Europe and America. You know, they were nops. They were ubiquitous in 19th century culture.
There was often more to freak shows than simple exploitation, even for the most famous act of the time, Joseph Merrick, who would become known as the elephant.
You know, when we think entertainers like Joseph Merrick, the Elephant Man, who was managed by Tom Norman, I mean, the great British showman, you know, we think of Merrick as being this kind of cringing victim of a cruel system.
Our understanding of the plight of the Elephant Man comes largely from a fictionalised account of his life, which was brought to the screen by filmmaker David Lynch.
Ladies and gentlemen, the terrible Elephant Man. Stand up.
Stand up!
Bigger bites, who's drunk, who beats the guy, whips him,
Bites, don't!
Where have you been?
Well, actually, Lynch had existed. And the accounts we have, the dominant account of the life of Merrick, comes from the Dr. Frederick Treves, you know, Anthony Hopkins in the movie, and John Merrick. In real life, he was called Joseph Merrick. He was on what most modern entertainers would find a pretty good deal. He was on a 50-50 box office split with Tom Norman. You can see Merrick as a victim, if you want. You could also see him as a man who has managed to find a way of making his physical extraordinariness into a way of making a living, a way of having in the world.
Throughout the Victorian era, freak shows continued to draw crowds at fairs across Britain. But people also went to the fair to experience the first, which had emerged in the 19th century. These early rides were built from wood and powered by hand or pulled by ponies. They would soon be transformed by the invention of steam power in the second half of the 19th century.
The 19th century fairs are two areas, the kind of pre-industrial and the post-industrial. And the Industrial Revolution hits the fair a lot later than people realise. It's about in 1861 at Bolton New Year Fair when Thomas Hearst brought... So what they did was bring the latest modern aspect of the Industrial Revolution, steam power, into an old fairground ride, which was a kind of would be a hand-turned roundabout, put them together, and we get what's called the merry-go-round. So the British round, the classic roundabout that we see all over the world now.
At first, these steam-powered merry-go-rounds were run by an engine which was fixed to the outside of the ride. This technology was improved by an engineer from King's Lynn, Frederick.
He went to a show in his native Norfolk and saw there a small fairground ride that was being powered. Now, it is said that Frederick Savage looked at this, and what he did, and this was the most important thing about it, was that instead of having the steam engine outside the ride, the term centre engine
would mean bigger and more ornate rides could be built, carrying more people, and as a result, his fairground business became one of the largest.
His workforce increased to about 400. And he was producing rides for showmen the length and breadth of the country. None of the designs that he built were, in a sense, original to him, but he was a great one for taking other people's ideas and making a succession of rides that he built from the 1870s onwards, became the star attractions at the fairs in the last three decades of the 19th century. First is, then there were the switchback rides, and they were the grand rides of the fairground. And the Razzle Dazzle, a rather in which spun round and tilted. And it was the sort of ride that was described in its day as a oncer. You went on it once and never again.
It would have been quite atmospheric, really, lots of steam, the centre engine. So it would have been a lot of hard work as well, because you would have had to stoke the boiler and get steam up, power to produce the power to drive the thing round. You've had an organ playing as well, a paper organ, a barrel organ, so you would have had the sort of military, waltzes and marches. You've had a bit of a industrial noise from the steam engines, and then the sort of entertainment element really was the organ music.
Some local authorities banned them, because of the noise. And they were quite dangerous at one point, because there was no way people did know. And a really powerful steam roundabout from the 19th century with steam power at full speed is quite a scary thing. And nowadays, when you see the modern steam fairs, they don't really... They're quite gentle and old people go in them. But at the time, they're the white-knuckle ride of their day.
Beginning with these new steam-powered rides, the Victorian Fairground was at the forefront of industrial and technological innovation.
By the end, the Fairground has become a piece of Victorian technology as the Crystal Palace or a trade fair. The same technologies that are transforming Britain's communications and travel systems, the same technologies that are sending steamships out across the world and lots of stuff, they're also transforming how Victorians have a night out. They get into these devices, and steam is it.
By the end of the 19th century, the people who ran Britain's travelling fairs had become recognised as a distinct community.
The showman will tell you that show people are born, not made, but this kind of crucible of the 19th century, the mid-19th century, you got people coming, you had people coming from Ireland, you had some aspects of the travelling community coming in, you had people who were theatrical people, strolling players, and becomes this crucible of mixing everything in until they become the showman.
Unlike other popular entertainments that emerged in the Victorian era, like there has traditionally been the domain of a closed community.
I think the difference, my family and people always said, the difference between the circus and the fair is that you can run away to the circus, but you can't run away to the fair. So it's this closed community, which was described in the 19th century as a village on wheels.
But despite the popularity of the travelling fairs, the fairground community were often viewed with suspicion and hostility. These negative attitudes towards travelling people were a hangover of stereotypes which date back to the medieval era.
I think there is a mistrust in, and it still exists, for all travelling people. You do have this sort of influx of foreigners, as it were, other parts of the country. It was then, therefore, easy to blame them for things that happened in the town. So, for instance, towards the end of the 19th century and into the 20th century, show people were blamed for disease, spreading disease. They were thought of as being the carriers of measles. So measles there were fair people in the town, they must have been the carriers. And so it was therefore easy of saying, well, we don't want these people in our town. And the great and the good often did do that.
The This hostility led to a proposal in Parliament that the fairground community should face limits on their ability to travel around the country. Men of the era met to defend their transient lifestyle.
A meeting was called at the Black Lion Hotel in Salford, attended by the leading lights of the day, Pat Collins, the Studs, the Whites from Scotland, and so on. And they agreed that they would form a group to be known as the United Kingdom Van Dwellers Protection Association. And its aim was to oppose and hopefully defeat this bill that was being proposed in Parliament. It took them 4 years to do it, but eventually they made enough friends in both houses of Parliament to have this bill kicked out.
This group was renamed the Showman's Guild of Great Britain and would now represent the community who ran Britain's fairgrounds.
It's a very effective organisation, but it was of the showmen, but then it was there to protect the fairs, and it's still very effective.
These showmen would orchestrate the showcasing innovations of the age. In the final years of the 19th century, Victorians raced to the fair to wonder at the marvel of the cinema. It was on the fair this most important cultural invention was first widely shown.
And the cinematograph was shown in February 1897 at King's Lynn Fair, but also in December 1896 at the Royal Agricultural Hall at the World's Fair. And it was classed as the wonder of the age, the dawn of modern life. People loved it because what the showmen did, they would go to town a week before, make a film, and then show it at the fair and say, come and see yourselves on the screen, showing 10 shows a day. They showed continuous film minutes. They bought films from all over the world. They commissioned titles. Méliès, Pathé, all the big filmmakers, all the big film companies sold direct to the showmen. You would have 14 cinematograph shows at Hull Fair alone in 1901. And people for this wonderful action. And it wasn't until 1909 that permanent cinemas were first 13 years of its life. Cinema belonged to and was born on the fairground.
Into the first decade of the 20th century, Britain's industrial heartlands were expanding, and these growings demanded popular entertainment. In areas like South Wales, it was the travelling fair first to meet this demand.
Something that could burst into the town and, like a rocket, you know, explode all over it. These were very much workaday towns, workaday villages, terraces, particularly in the South Wales coalfields, springing up overnight. They didn't, at this stage, let's say 1890s, early 1900s, particularly have the later workmen's institutes and libraries and gymnasiums. They didn't necessarily have music hall theatres. The Empire in Tonopandy is opened in 1909. What they did have, therefore, breaking into their workaday existence, were the traditional aspects of working class life, even for the fair.
In these communities, working men were drawn to the fairground boxing booths, where they could challenge the show.
You'd have guys coming off night shifts. You'd have ready money to spend, because these were young, very fit colliers by and large. You know, this was a very masculine kind of society. And they would arrive and they would see, let's say, Black Jack Scarrett's box. Jack would have his picked men parading in front of the crowd. He would say, you know, my man here will have his hands tied behind his back. And if anybody can land a blow on him within a minute, here's a goal. I mean, just to hit this guy whose hands are tied behind his back, and you must against somebody who was, say, 7 stone or even less, soaking wet, like little Jimmy Wilde. And you're 5'10" or even 5'8", you're 10 stone.
Fighters like Jimmy Wilde and fellow Welshman Jim Driscoll emerged from the Fairground boxing booths to become world champions in their own right and were later inducted into the Boxing Hall of Fame.
I think the classic boxing story in terms of the boxing booth would be Jimmy Wilde. Jimmy Wilde, born in 1892, growing up in the Rhondda, a tiny man, very long arms, not somebody you would have ever imagined could be a boxer. But of course, in that time, in that place, and with his physical fitness and his stamina, he soon was. And he naturally would have gravitated towards the box, despite looking tiny and sickly, as an expert knockout artist. And that's the key, of course, with Wilde, was that he could knock people out by a combination of, I don't know, technique and efficiency. And yet, at the same time, if you saw him, you think you'd have a good chance. One Easter bank holiday in Jack Scarrett's booths in Swansea, he knocked 22 men out. And in Wilde's case, very rapidly, this boxing booth phenomenon, 1900s to 1908, 1909, was going to gravitate to the sport and the ability of working men like Wilde to become, by 1916, champion of the world, which he remains until 1922, but out, absolutely straight out of the boxing booth.
The boxing booths eventually declined as the sport began to become fully professional. Today.
All the elements that you see in modern boxing today are from the fair. The way that the people come onto the ring, the way they issue the challenge to rumble, that's just like the reason why boxing as a sport actually also has this kind of weird reputation. It's because of those showman aspects of it, the showman roots. People don't think of it as a sport, they think of it as entertainment.
After the ground entered a new modern age.
What's interesting, the Edwardian age and then the Edwardian age of the fairground. But what I find fascinating is, and I call it the push-button fair, where suddenly you get the electric fair. The fair becomes modern, sleek. You get the waltzer. Every generation thinks it's theirs. In the 1920s, now how mundane does that sound? In the 1950s, it's the rock and roll waltzer. In the 1970s, it's the disco waltz. 1980s, it's the rave machine. What an amazing ride. The same ride has been exciting children or people or teenagers for over 80 years.
The invention of electric lights would change the experience there.
Electric lighting was probably seen by most people for the first time at their local fair. They didn't have lighting in their houses. They'd been used to paraffin lamps, candles. But to go to the fairground and see the rows of bright bulbs was something.
But it was an electric ride from America in 1928 that really caught the imagination.
This is at the top of it. How does it work? Can I get that person back? No, ba-dumph. You bash, you clash, you go around in circles, you never get where you're going.
The Dodgems caused a sensation on fairs across the country and would go on to become the most popular ride of the 20th century.
The great beauty of a ride on the Dodgem is their ground, where you are in control as the rider. The man behind the rit is a kid, because you wanted to be there, you wanted to drive. Not old enough to have a license and drive a car on the road, but you could drive a car on the Dodgem track, and more to the point, you could bump into another car.
With the coming of electricity to the fair, the bulky steam rides of the Victorian era were replaced by electric-powered attractions like the Dodgems, which could offer a faster, more thrilling experience.
The advance of fairground rides is entirely dependent upon the technology to support them, not just the engines that drove them, but also the metals, the engineering that could actually build the rides. They are actually quite simple in concept. I mean, they all depend on arcs and circles. You either go round and round, or you go up and down, or you go up and down and round, but it is all based on a sort of simple concept. But the implications are introduced by the advances in technologies.
Out of this new electric age emerged many of the rides that we see today. In the years leading up to the Second World by the Ghost Train, the Skid, the Mont Blanc, and the Speedway. At the outbreak of the Second World War, many fairs were forced to close down, and the fairground community, like everyone else in Britain, did their bit to help defend the country.
All walks of life contributed to the war effort. I mean, our community lost quite a lot. But what the fairground community did, they got together and raised a fund to pay for an aeroplane, a Spitfire. And that Spitfire was called the Fun of the Fair.
The women operated the fairs. They raised within 9 months £4,000 purely from the showmen to buy a Spitfire for the nation, because they didn't have any money. The government didn't have enough Spitfires. So £4,000 they raised, and we're rightly proud of that.
The years following the end of the would see reach the peak of its popularity in Britain, with people keen to enjoy themselves after 6 years of conflict.
The post-war years were a particularly good time on the fairground. We'd emerged from war somewhat hard up. It was the age of austerity. There was rationing, but there was more or less war in work. They had money, but they had very little to spend it on because of rationing. So the entertainment industry in general, whether it be the theatre, the cinema, the fairground or the circus camps, did very busy time for showmen.
Changing, Victorian favourites like the freak shows were on the wane in line with new social attitudes.
Well, I can give you the reason in a nutshell. So there was plenty of fat ladies, tattooed ladies, armless men, midgets, dwarfs, etc. But in those days, the people were poorer, and they were only too happy to have their children earn a living. And that was how the showmen came together and put them on exhibition. But today, in a welfare state, there's anything at all about these people.
Through by Wild West shows. One of the most famous Wild West show families in 50s Britain was the Shufflebottoms. Florence began performing in her father's show from the age of 13.
As I World War, I was 13, and I joined my father with their little sideshow that they had. And I used to stand for my throwing. And I did love dancing. I love dancing now, but I can't. My knees are gone.
The Shufflebottom family had been presenting their Wild West show for three generations. Legend had it that Florence's great-grandfather was in the 1880s with the popular American showman Buffalo Bill.
Buffalo Bill came over to England in the 1880s, and according to the family story, Texas Bill came over with Buffalo Bill's Wild West show, but I don't think I've ever heard of an American cowboy called Shufflebottom.
More like them, and that is a Lancashire name. And do know for a fact, on Father's Day, everybody had horses, and he was very good with horses, I believe.
10 children, and each of it one was the Colorados and the Florence Shufflebottom. Her father was known as Ricardo Colorado.
Florence was such a skilled performer that she soon began in the 1950s.
And the smash hit musical, Annie Get Your Gun, was on at the Went to See It. So, of course, doing the sharpshooting and wearing these costumes and Annie Get Your Gun being popular, I got a lot of publicity out of that because I was known as the British Annie Oakley.
Anything you can do, I can do better. Do anything better. Can. Yes, I can.
She could do Wild West, she could do sharpshooting, she could do knife throwing. Showmen over a certain age will go weak about Florence Shufflebottom. She was the pin-up girl, such an amazing performer.
But my father wanted me to do the sharps he wanted to do because I didn't like firearms then and I don't like them now. But I wanted to help my father. It made it easier for him. And he trained me to do the shooting.
But Florence's career shooter ended after an accident during one performance.
And I was very good at it, although I say so myself, I was very good at it. I was very confident until one day, and it wasn't my fault. And I shot my mother in the finger knuckle. She was holding three pipes in a spray fashion like that against the target board. And I was laid down on the floor and I had to shoot that way. Now, the rifle I was using was a pump action rifle. And as you did that, the empty cartridge, empty shell went over your shoulder. And a little boy in the audience jumped up to catch it, knocked me, and the rifle came off and the bullet went through my mother's knuckle. And from that, I knew I could do it. But I didn't enjoy it anymore. Where before I used to enjoy performing, I didn't enjoy doing the shooting.
There's no business like show, like...
But this accident didn't dent Florence's fairground career, as she soon began performing with live snakes.
Soon you'll be appearing.
We had three and two big ones. We used to take the small one out of the box and show it to the audience, then put it round me. And most people would go, oh! You know, snakes, you know. And when they got used to seeing you with a small snake, then you'd go and pick up the big snake. Well, they was really amazed at that. And then I used to finish the performance by doing what they call the kiss of death. Now, I never, and if you look at all the photographs you have of me, I never held a snake's head like that. I always let the snakes be free, had my hand underneath the snakes. And they got that they used to do it of their own accord. I used to stand like that, and open my mouth, and they put that in my mouth, and that was called the kiss of death, and that used to finish my performance.
Let's go on with the show.
While flooring 50s crowds, the sights and sounds of the fairground around her were about to be revolutionised by the arrival.
Rock and roll was.
And it was the only place, really, you could hear loud rock and roll for absolutely nothing.
And you have sort of unholy alliance between bright lights and things going fast and popular music.
It was not a place for your parents' music. It was rock and roll. Hand in hand with the idea of Teddy Boys, with the beginnings of youth culture, with youth fashions, the post-war period. Go and spend it wherever they wanted, and the fairground was an essential part of that ostentation.
And with the amazing arena, for all of this, because you've got the technology that can pump this stuff out, but you've also got a stage upon which mods and rockers can come and preen and exhibit themselves, you know, stand under flattering electric light.
They say the joint was a-rocking, going round and round, yeah, reeling and rocking, what a crazy sound.
The coming of rock and roll led to the, and with Fairground to the new music, the fair now seemed to belong to teenagers.
Rose out of my seat, just had a day.
I can remember seeing my first Teddy Boys at a fairground and being absolutely fascinated by this idea of the exotic other with the Edwardian velvet collars and the cowboy bootlace ties. These were the people our parents were and we wanted to be them.
So magnificent. Peak paraded through the...
Throughout the 50s and 60s, Fairgrounds became a place where boys and girls would go to meet.
It's very hard for us to imagine. There were very, very few places for courting in the 1950s. And the fair would arrive as this zone of liberty. Go there, not to transgress particularly, but just to shout at one another, to eye one another up, to do la marcha. The girls would walk down one side, the boys would walk down the other. You'd eye each other up. Fashions would be spotted.
The fair was the high point of boyfriend for the pair. You couldn't go on your own. If you went with a girl, if you went with your best friend, you'd sort of failed.
There's a sort of sexual charge about the fairground too, because it's the kind of place where boys and girls might get together away from the parental eye, you know, go down the tunnel of love, or up on the Ferris wheel, you know, your dad can't see what you're doing up there. And where young people go in packs and gangs and can face each other on.
By the 1960s, rides had arrived at the fair, which added to the youthful edginess of the whole fair. Boom, 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 boom.
Go down. There were rides, really, which originated in the United States. There was a ride called the Dive Bomber, which set you through 360 degrees. Boom, 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 boom. And the Ferris wheel became very made by an American company. If you think of a big wheel or this dive bomber, it was a teenage boy and girlfriend in there.
And you hoped that boys would take you on a scary ride, because then that would give them the excuse to put their arm around you to make sure you...
The girl being frightened next to you as you come down, vroomph, into the water flume or up on the big one. We're kidding, we know what this is about. You've made out, you've copped base, you've done whatever. Area where anything goes. It's a no man's land. It's also areas that were considered quite dangerous by boys because you could go into a fight with another gang. Yeah. Or the girl you fancied might go off with a fairground boy. The romanticism of the gypsy and Gypsy David. Late last night when the squire came home looking for his lady, but she's gone. She's gone off with the raggle-taggle gypsies. Oh, why do you leave your goose-feather bed? All for the love of David.
It was late last night when the boss come home. He's asking about his lady. The only answer he received, she's gone with the gypsy David.
Well, you see, like you see them walking around, and you look at a few, and you know, they look a bit, they've got some money or something like that. Well, you don't bother with them. You look for the ones that's going around a bit poor looking, you see. Then you've got more chance with them. You know, a bit rough looking. You know what I mean?
A bit rough now, what do you mean?
Well, they don't. You know, you see some going around, they wouldn't speak to you, look at you, or like that. You know, if you call them over to anything, and they just. You know, you're on the summit there, you see. They start chatting to you.
There in the light of the camping car, star baby. Her heart in tune with the big guitar, and the voice of the gypsy sang in that song of the gypsy day.
And they were always so cool. They'd be there in the middle of the dodgems going round, and they'd be leaning there, looking for all the world as if they owned it. And they'd walk out as the dodgems were going around. If I'd walked out, I would have fallen flat on my face. They'd come out and they'd lean on a dodgem as the girls were there. And they knew what they were doing.
Mm-hmm. But this was the high tide of fairground popularity. Country, but through the 1970s, they began competing for teenage time and money. Candy floss remained, the son of the boxing booths, and disappeared. In the 1980s, a new style of entertainment from America. Feats. Places like Alton Towers quickly became among the most popular tourist attractions. But these high-tech amusements drew a low-tech response in the form of vintage fairs, which tapped into a now growing feeling of nostalgia for the traditional fair.
Nowadays with the fair, people have a nostalgia for a type of fair, and I think that the best example of the kind of really beautiful, perfect, ideal fair that people think of from their childhood, and now we're all getting older, is the fair that the Carter family, Carter Steam Fair. Which steam fair is not, it's actually Carter's fair, 1900s to the 1950s on their fair. All the equipment is beautiful, it's impeccably looked after. But they're only like those from 100 years ago who came and added something new.
Today, attracted to Carter's Steam Fair for the experience of being taken back in time to the golden age of the fairground.
Public, a much more novel experience, because our rides, some of them are steam driven, so they're ranging from 1895 right through to rock and roll. So they come along, and I mean, it's been described as more like a film set than a fun fair, but they can ride on everything. And we play old music, and I mean, it's just like going back into the past, really. And we're very non-aggressive. So we attract families, and we just like to give them what fun was like before it got too technical.
Now it's become part of the nostalgic world of the fairground, so that the steam fair is now something where little wooden ducks that go up and down and enter this painted world that's been commuted out of the 1961st.
For over 200 years, fairs have brought their special magic to towns across Britain. Through innovation and fairs, characters, shows and rides created our first popular entertainment industry. And there are still 4,000 show families putting on around 200 fairs a week. As ever, the allure of the fairground lies in the way it arrives in our midst, and then, just as suddenly.
I think that idea of fairs being transitory, they're not illusory because they've happened and you might have the goldfish. A friend might have run off with the Dodgems guy, but you've been there and you've taken part in this thing that's disappeared. And there's something quite magic about that. You've been there, you've taken part in it, and it's disappeared. The field where things had been, they've packed up their tents and gone in.
It was the marks in the grass and the rings in the grass. The rings appear, the fair's there, and then they go, and as they vanish, and then they grow back again, just in time for the fair to come again.
And Timeshift is back at the same time next week. Next this evening, exploring a kingdom that revelled in sophisticated art, complex architecture and enormous wealth. Heading to Morocco with Gus Casely-Hayford and the Lost Kingdoms of Africa. Next.